All right. Let's wait for the people, maybe. All right. So for the final presentation, two of my colleagues from Algorithmic are going to be presenting. So I've been tasked with trying to pronounce their names in English. So Nicolas Paulhac and Pierre Maheut. Pierre Maheut and Nicolas Paulhac, round of applause for them.
Thank you, Alexandre.
And they'll be talking about the stuff they've been working on recently for Substance Source and what Sebastian teased this morning as well.
Thank you, Alexandre. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for the people that are viewing us online. So in today's presentation, we will be talking about the Substance Source automotive drop, and especially what has been done for it to produce the materials that has been produced. But maybe even before starting, you could ask, why is Algorithmic doing automotive drop? And the answer is pretty simple. You will see, first of all, we already have a lot of users and customers that are using Substance for texturing assets for automotive. It could be in game, as you have seen in presentation of Sebastian this morning, the Forza series, the Gran Turismos, and also mobile video games that are automotive are textured with Substance. Also VFX, as are doing a lot of advertisement. You have just seen the mill right before. And even more, obviously, design. So as we have almost today all car manufacturers, I did not put all of them, but just name a few, especially starting with Jaguar Land Rover as we are here. We also, on top of OEMs, have also the CGI studio, the people that are specialized in providing experience for still images, but also VR, AR, and real-time experiences. There is another thing that motivated us was about the fact that the pipeline is changing in all those places, but especially in automotive design. What was the regular pipeline was doing still images, like this one done by David. And this pipeline was mostly using 3ds Max or Maya combined to an offline renderer. This offline renderer, here it's Octane, could be V-Ray, Corona, is taking you minutes and even more hours to produce this kind of image. And if you wanted to produce an image that was two times the size of it, then it will take longer to render. So that was what we call the offline rendering. But since 2 years now, especially with the presentation of Unreal at GDC 2016, we've seen that real-time can now catch up the quality of the offline renderers and provide a real interactive real-time experiences. And even more recently at Unite Berlin, so it was 2 days ago, we presented there, and Unity were presenting their new HDRP pipeline, showing the quality that they can reach today in Unity. So there is a lot of advantages going real-time, of course. The interaction you can get and the way that it's displayed to the audience. Good news about that is that as Substance is PBR-based, you can have your former pipeline and move to a new pipeline, or having the two pipelines together by having the same library of materials using Substance. Something that also accelerated this move to real-time is all VR, AR, MR, XR experiences. So here it's an example that we show on our website of a Kia in VR. And something that is key when you are producing VR experiences to be immersed in a real experience is also the environment. It's key for having something interesting. And as you have seen this morning with Max, it's something that today visualization artists are paying a lot of attention to. And that's also where Substance can help. Last point, but probably the most important, is about creativity and productivity. And to do that, we have Substance Designer to create the materials. So with Substance Designer, you can iterate and find new materials as your color, material, and finish designer. You can also match references by scanning existing materials, as you have seen before. So this kind of details is really key for car manufacturers, especially when they need to position themselves for premium brand, for instance. They are looking to find the most exclusive materials, and they also are looking to see how it will react to light and how it will react next to each other. Second point was productivity. So with Substance Source, we are able to provide and to texture very quickly an asset and have a first idea about how it will look like. So when you have this mesh and you want to try different harmony of color, material, finish together, what you would use is just having the mesh and very quickly drag and drop materials and check out it, how it will look like. And then if you need and want to spend more time on one specific materials, you can of course do it. As in Substance Source, when we release a material, you have the archive file, meaning the one that you can directly tweak, but also the SBS file and see how it has been designed.
Okay. So first I would like to speak a little bit about the Substance Source and what Substance Source is, and it's obviously our online PBR material library. The content is most entirely produced by the team that we have at Algorithmic of artists creating materials for the library and materials with a large diversity with different categories, types of materials. And those types of materials are dedicated to very different types of users, from game and VFX assets to architecture and design materials. What all the materials have in common, really, is about the fact that every single asset has parameters that you can tweak and modify, making every single material a single library within the library. So obviously I would like to show you a little bit what we are working on at the moment, and we started to release on Substance Source platform, and obviously it's Automotive. So not going back on the why aspect, I would like just to show you a little bit the process that we have followed. Working with professionals, we've been identifying the types of materials that we wanted to create in order to give a maximum of asset to be able for our users to texture vehicles. So splitting, obviously, the materials in two categories, from exterior materials to interior materials, and also defining the types of in specific aspect, the material that we will create. This is a special project because that's a project that actually will be covering a very large type of materials, from paints and composites, very different from each other, which we could call base materials, materials that you can actually mix together in order to create something, to materials that are a little bit more dedicated to automotive, where you would sort of generate different patterns and part design. And also from interior materials, you have the very different categories, from metals to leather, textiles and wood, behaving every single one with specific parameters. The way that basically we actually set up every single category is identifying a specific need for certain types of materials that will enable us to actually define the types of parameters that we want to expose, giving the artist and the user maximum control over how the material will behave. It's a very special project also in the nature of how we produced the materials, because this is the very first production where we actually mixed several types of workflows, from fully procedural workflows to scan-based, which is starting from the capture to create a digital materials that has the ability to tile, but also to actually be modified in certain aspects, enabling manufacturers, for example, to actually create catalogs and libraries of materials and save time by capturing only one materials and creating the different colors variation, to what we would call hybrid materials, which are a little bit more complex, which because they are blending procedural and scan-based, picking the accuracy of the grain of the materials that you scan, adding on top of it procedural filters that actually create more complex materials such as assemblies. And one interesting aspect also is that you will also be able, from the platform Substance source, to be able to have access to those graphs, making this library also a great platform to actually learn how materials are made, but also to use every materials as a starting point, whether you just tweak the parameters that we expose, or also pick some bits and pieces from the graph and creating your own procedural filters on top of it.
So just to sum up in figures what has been produced, we will be releasing, and we started a couple of weeks ago already, more than 500 PBR tweakable materials. Based on that, we have an average of 3 presets per materials, meaning that we have more than 1,500 material presets. And keep in mind that for each of those materials, you are able to load it and to tweak all the parameters. And so in the end, you can do an infinity of variations.
Okay, so then I would like to speak about a little bit more in detail about with a few examples of how we created materials. The first goal of the materials that we created is to be photorealistic, and to be photorealistic and believable, we have to understand how materials are made. And looking at, for example, car paints, how car paints are actually produced, with this layering of base coat and clear coat on top of each other to create some specific effects, and also the way that it's applied on the to the metal panels, creating some very specific effects. And we had to understand that in order to produce the SBS graph in the different channels that would actually be able to recreate those variations, and the SBS graph will then drive a custom shader being able to reproduce this complex material behavior of the layering of the different coatings, which is basically helping us produce that kind of stuff with the simulation of the orange peel, of the normal, of the clear coat, and the different size, shape, and glossiness of flakes from different car paints. But taking that thing a step forward, using the car paints are just a single element, and blending that with more procedural filters, like the patterns that you could find on the side of cars or the grills. So putting complexity over the car paints to create some patterns, which are also tweakable, by the way. Okay. So basically, from source, what's going to be new is, alongside the SBSAR and the SBS file, you will be able to download a MDL graph, which is going to enable you to, on one side, use a pre-set up shader materials if you want to use that into any software that has the integration. But if you have already your own custom shaders, you also have the possibility to use only the SBS graph to drive your custom shader and plug every map into your shader to actually be able to tweak the specific parameters that we included into it, like this example using C4D.
And Redshift.
Move along to a different type of production we have, and this involved basically hybrid materials creation. And the goal is basically to use the best of both worlds, having the accuracy of scanned material and the flexibility of procedural filters to actually being able to create from a single piece of real sample materials that actually behave like assembly generators. And for that, we've been looking at how leather samples are made and how the stitching is done to actually expose the right parameters. And we've been generating those materials that actually you can modify every aspect of the stitching, from the puncture, the orientation of the thread, the colors, and the different attributes of those materials on leather, obviously, on textile, on alcantaras, which are heavily used in the automobile industry as well, to creating different types of seams, overlapping leather on top of each other with some specific parameters for the seams, or actually having the thread crossing the seams of the leather. And all those parameters are tweakable and modifiable by the user.
So that's another example about the usage of Substance Source within here a real-time engine that is Unity. So directly from Unity, without even opening your Internet Explorer, Chrome, whatever, you can directly browse source, select a material that you would like to apply, here like a dotted plastic, and then on the fly, what the plugin that we have in Unity is doing is that it will automatically generate the maps, plug the maps for you, and then being able to be tweaked. So if you are changing the color, the tiling, or whatever, on the fly, we're able to generate the maps and give you a feedback directly in the real-time engine. So that's how the artist, in the end, can use directly in the game engine, real-time, the materials and how they will tweak it to apply it to their project. So it's a very simple example, but that's how fast you can use Substance Source.
Okay, so alongside photorealistic, we wanted to also offer the creative freedom to users to be able to actually create more than what more materials than the materials that actually they need for their projects. So from car designer that might need to browse between a large library of different sculpts for tire threads, to with the same opportunity to be able to input their own 2D bitmaps to actually create their own tire thread, to taking into account the lifetime of the product, animating the substance to actually create weathering on top of the tire thread, to even take into consideration the environment and the weather condition, having the materials changing depending on the weathering conditions. But this does not apply only to rubber. We've been having this approach of designing materials for the entire library, from base materials to combination of materials that actually create those blended materials, creating assemblies and replication of actually part design. And this is an example of the different parameters that you can tweak using those lighting elements that you would actually commonly find on the headlamps of cars, but can also be used in architecture as well, and the level of control that you have over every parameters. Something that is also quite kind of representative of the level of control we can have over the materials is basically having the license plate. So you would be able to have control over every aspect of these materials, being able to change the text, the surface texture of every part, importing the bitmaps that you need to be able to recreate the specific type of license plates that you need. But we wanted to go just a step further, and with this sort of understanding of how we can sort of blend texturing and modeling together, the goal being to have just enough modeling to the right modeling to get the right results. And we've been doing what we sort of call internally material-driven design, is basically enabling designers to be able to iterate using shape and material at the same time before actually modeling the part, and iterate and produce more variation for design decisions and interaction that can and go back then into the process. So
Nicolas, maybe we can go back on the slide before. I don't know if it was clear for everyone. Here it's a flat plan, and that's the texture. And that's because of displacement and opacity masks that we're able to generate all that. So all the thing that you see after is in fact a flat plane.
Yep. So it's exactly that. Thank you. And so we've been doing this exercise with many types of materials from the car industry, up to more complex combination of different types of materials to those brake discs as well.
And
it's still a flat plane, and would you just click, drag your materials onto it, and that's what you get at the end. But being able to actually understand how material behave is just one thing. The other thing we wanted to do is just to understand workflows of people from the car industry, but also workflows of our user in general. And the best way to do that is to actually take out the same constraint and go through the same step that designers and artists go through to actually make the visuals and play with materials. And so that's why we decided to actually create our own concept car, to actually go through those different steps and understand how things work and how industry pipelines can be using Substance to gain time and creativity. And this concept, and we even found a name for the show car, and it's based on the very first name of the game of the engine, of the Substance engine from the very first project of Sébastien, Stacy's project, and it's the name is Ixtéon, which is short for the art of noise. And that's it for the little story. And this is basically how it looks. So we've been working with our artists internally, but also from professionals and friends from the industry, providing us the knowledge and the know-how of making, you know, the car design.
The best thing probably is to showcase a little bit of the background of the back of the car also, and then we will invite exterior designer, exterior designers, 3D modeler, and CGI artists that work on it. So can everybody have a round of applause for Takumi, Frederic, and Lionel, and they will tell them. So first, Takumi. That's a mic. That's Takumi.
Hello, this is Takumi Yamamoto. I'm founder of Takumi Yamamoto, and I've been designing car for 20 years. So I spent 14 years at Peugeot and Citroën. Then I joined Polyphony Digital, so Sony Computer Entertainment. And this car was actually what I proposed when I was at Citroën. This is the first car driving prototype which is dedicated to a video game, which was Gran Turismo. And yeah, this is a racing version. This only exists in a game. It doesn't exist elsewhere. So since I, so after Polyphony, I started my company, and I'm doing this kind of like one-off cars for real and the virtual. And at this moment, I'm working on project called Divi. It's Divi Bowie. He was my hero, and it's him in form of a car. So it's a portrait. So painter uses the oil. I use a car as a. So this is what I'm working on, and yeah. Since then, since I did the GT by Citroën, I started to get an offer or becoming a specialist of designing virtual car. So I think that's why Pierre contacted me. And
yeah, and we were very happy to work together on this project. What is very nice with you, Takumi, is also we algorithmic are coming from game and we extend to industry, and you are coming from the industry and extend to game. So it's a great way to cross our passes are crossing. Exactly. Maybe we can now introduce Frederick, who work on a really, really regular basis with you.
Good afternoon. I'm Frederic Gasson. I come from the technical part to design a car. So I started designing fuel tanks that have nothing to see with design. But fascinated about nice shapes, I decided to do a design school and trying to make some 3D shapes into CATIA and those NURBS software. But I couldn't find my way first. And then I met a guy working at Renault Design, and he showed me a software named Alias that people know in all design studios to model shapes for the industry. So I had the chance to work for Renault, for Bugatti, for Daniel Simon, to model surfaces that we can produce after that. I never worked with a video game before. The only console I had is Takumi that offered me one like 4 years ago when we had a project together. But I only drove the Citroën GT on it, and that's it. Probably my son growing up will try it, I don't know. But I'm really amazed about seeing what we can do in this video game or picturing industry. What I do is 3D surfaces for production. But what we'd like to have, like we have this 21-inch screen, and then it goes to production, but in between, we need to have as much reality as possible to try the materials and stuff like that, and if possible, real time. And what you are bringing now in the industry with this high render texture, like really can be very helpful in design studios. And I can imagine that soon in our studio, then having a designer that is able to test his material himself, testing the wheels, designing himself in 3D without knowing how to model it properly in 3D for production, which is a job which is very technically, you need technical skills to be able to produce a wheel in 3D that it works later. But to produce the design, it's in the mind of the guy that have the ideas of it, like the designer. We don't ask the designer to know how to model exactly all those surfaces to make them nice. This is the work of the modeler. And between those two worlds, then there's always kind of a fight, like the designer have an idea, he needs to have a nice translator. And having these new products working on those texturing things, that can be very helpful, and I can't wait to see the next steps.
You do even more than car. You also do such kind
of things. Now I work more and more in the yacht industry, because working for car industry means like being in the design studios. And for family reasons, I decided to work from Normandy, and I'm very happy to have my studios in Caen. There, I go very often in Paris, and for those picturing and images reasons, I have an associate which have a studio in Toulouse, and he's responsible for virtual reality. We are preparing some configurators. He's got a material scanner, and I see him as a specialist, like probably most of you here guys, the guys that is doing the nice pictures. So I associate with him that if I do a 3D, now he can do nice pictures, because I know nothing about pictures. So we have this company, we have new people coming in the company to model and to support VRED and Alias modeling, and to reply to our customers for the yacht industry. That's pretty much it.
Awesome. Switching now to Lionel. The fun story about Lionel and how we kind of met. As we said, architecture and design are still pretty new to algorithmic, about like 2 years and a half ago, we kind of started to address the market, and to do so, we started a Facebook community and a selection of cool renderings that are made for architecture and design. And that was the very first picture that we found on Behance of somebody who did a curtain that looked like so real, doing using Substance Designer, and that was Lionel. And a couple of years later, we were able to do a project together. That's the one we are presenting.
So basically, I started my career in 2012 at Pixomondo Berlin, working mostly on environment, big environments, doing mostly rocks and cliffs. I was using ZBrush and Mari for this. And then Pixomondo closed in Berlin, so I reoriented myself into the architecture visualization because I study architecture, traditional architecture in school. So it was kind of easier to because I had the 3D skills, so I worked at Pure Rendering in the architecture visualization. And that's where I started using Substance Designer because mostly all the samples we received from the client were really, really tiny, and I had to reproduce them and make them tileable and bigger. So I started using Designer in 2014, I think. And
That's it. So we will deep dive a little bit in the process of how we create the car together and have some close-ups on some specific topic. That's the regular process of creating a car in any car manufacturers. The first started with pen and paper, still today, and that's on the left a sketch from Takumi, one of the key sketch for the project, and then Frederick was based on SoSketch, modeling it in NURBS surfacing tools. Here it's Alias. It could have been iSensor or others. But that's the kind of thing that has been made. There is a little bit of work in between. that's the final part of it. But that's how you do. And then in the end, you have a texturing artist such as Lionel or Guillaume who produce this image that use Substance in order to apply the materials and create the renderings of the final car. So here is the final sketches of Takumi, and then maybe you can tell a little bit about some of the detail on it. Oh, you're happy with it. That's it. The interesting part is that we showed to Takumi a couple of textures and images, and he got pretty interested into generative design. And that's how you, for instance, came up with a light signature in the back with some hexagon and things like that, and you will see that it goes through the whole project. Then it was the turn of Frederick. So here is some screenshot directly from Alias. You won't tell about the patches, etc. It's maybe not the right time. He can take questions in the end. And then we selected this specific project within the project that is about the wheel design. So you can see the first key sketch of Takumi. And then we started to iterate with the team. So maybe Nicolas, you can tell.
Yes, so we basically went through the exercise of trying to go from a sketch to actually the final wheel that we used on the show car. So what you can see here and the big one over there is Takumi's sketch, and on the bottom is the type of iterations that we went through with our artist in Paris to actually tweak the forms and the materials together to actually find the right balance and what Takumi was actually looking for in terms of style. And so this is basically the materials that we actually applied on the show car. And as you can see here, there's very few modeling because you've only have two planes showcasing the brakes and the wheels, and you can see here the different iterations that you can go through, because this material is still tweakable and you can still do some modification to it. And this is basically the level of detail that we can go to in terms of quality to the reproducing the different bolts and the different forms that we that are part of the rim. And just to give you a little bit more real view of how it behave, this is a player video playing the substance, and here Gaetan is actually playing with the different parameters to actually create variations of the rims, even inputting the source logo to be on the badge over there.
And what did happen next is that based on this, so we iterate with Takumi with some intense call. And then when we were happy with the shape, we provide a displaced geometry. So starting from the plane, we created the tessellated version of the mesh, and then turned it to Frederick, and we were like, we hope you will be able to make something with it. And then he started to use it as reference. Yeah, maybe you can tell a little bit more about that.
Yeah, how it happens is pretty funny. In the car industry, this is not the way to model a wheel normally. Normally, the designer draw like 3, 4, 5 sketches, and then he spend his time trying to explain the modeler how to put the curve, how deep it needs to go, and maybe when it's a 5-spokes wheels, and maybe he wants to try a 7-spokes wheels, and then we have to redo the whole model as a modeler. So when all this iteration is made with this kind of programming texture, I told them, it was nearly at the beginning of the of our collaboration, okay, I don't do the wheel. That's a good thing, because sometimes a wheel can take the time of designing the car. It depends on the designers, but we are lucky, we have a good one here. But then here, when they sent me that FBX mesh,
yeah,
it was Monday.
Yeah.
They sent me that, and they were like, okay, try it. So the design is quite simple, but the definition was very good enough to be able to remodel NURBS on it, and then sending that for production. But we could even think about producing a stereolithography, a rapid prototyping model out of the texture. This I could imagine, like taking this FBX, closing the thing with a GeoMagic or a kind of software playing with those meshes without rebuilding it in NURBS. And that can be very, very interesting for small mockups. Scale one, I'm not sure right now, but honestly, we tried already some displacement maps, I remember like 10 years or 15 years ago. We can do that into Alias, but the result was so bad to use it later on producing prototypes that we forgot about that. It was just a nice try because we had time to lose. But then now we can really think that we can gain time into trying different 3D models for mockups out of those texture, without reproducing the NURBS like it is right now on that wheel.
Yeah, that's the thing. When you start to discuss with designers and 3D modelers and people in industrial design, they want to build it in the end. So that's always the case, and that's a good one. Another exploration we made together with Guillaume Meyer, part of the source team, is try to apply some textures on the door of the car. And that's the kind of thing that usually for a 3D modeler is like a nightmare. Most of the times it just quits right before you're starting this part. So that's the kind of thing that we made. Maybe you can share your experience about that.
Yeah, the experience is that now we got to model that in NURBS. We need to go to generative modeling softwares like Rhino Grasshopper or like Autodesk Dynamo. Which are based nearly on the same way of programming with blocks and with mathematics in between and doing like those shading, like those fading shapes and stuff like that. But this needs, for a modeler, like other skills, like mathematical skills and being able to put blocks together, which have nothing to see with the 3D modeling I used to do. So I'm really happy to to be able to integrate that with some graphists that don't know how to do it in NURBS, but I know that from those texture, when they trim it properly, I can get them in mesh and produce them in real.
Yeah, awesome. We will see more and more generative design.
Maybe the last part is about the picture that Lionel, you did. So here it's, as I said before, on VR and AR, and same thing for still images, the environment is really providing the mood around the car itself, and that's what you've been working on.
Yeah. So what I forgot to mention before, I'm working now at Staud Studio in Germany, Stuttgart, Germany, working on cars. Rendering mostly for AMG, and this is the picture I made with the awesome jobs from algorithmic teams. Maybe I can explain a bit the workflow. I think most of the materials are from Substance Source. A few of them are just tweaked a bit inside Substance Designer. We have carbon, we have gravel, with I think it's scanned,
yeah.
Gravel.
Photogrammetry.
The pillar is done in Substance Painter. We have the rims, which we just saw before. We have the lights. It's displacement texture. With emissive on the texture, and we have concrete everywhere, and car paint. The car paint is a basis of MDL. I just exported maps from Designer, and I plugged them into Max and V-Ray, and I blend them together. That's it.
And at that time, as Frederick said, the wheel is textures. It wasn't the mesh yet. So that's the kind of final image that you can produce using what I call the offline pipeline or offline rendering. So as Lionel mentioned, it is 3ds Max and V-Ray.
Yeah.
All right. So maybe you can ask yourself what's next. Interior design is coming. We will take the chance to share it and to show it to you a little bit later. So keep tuned.
And obviously, we'll be sharing a lot more materials in the coming weeks to go alongside the interior, because that's a subject that we would like to share with you as well. And of course, a lot more experiences, how to use the materials and using the mesh that we created to be able to showcase the workflows with you. But obviously the biggest thing is we can't wait to see what you will be able to do with it. And obviously we will be sharing this with the rest of the community, and you'll be able to play with it and texture it in many different ways.
Yeah, so thank you very much, Takumi, Frederick, and Lionel. And when you will be texturing the extern, you could think about Takumi, Frederick, and Lionel about that.
And a big thank you as well to the people from the team that are not physically here today, still in Paris, probably watching the football game. awesome job for
the whole team.
So
you have seen their name on many of the videos and the renderings that we've been showing. It has been an amazing job they have done and still doing. All right, we wanted to finish on some use cases coming from the industry, because in the end, all the thing that you have seen is to deliver even higher experience for our users, especially the people that are using Substance Source today. So there is of course the obvious examples of the game. Coming from Forza, it could be another one, and to produce an even more realistic visual. What is interesting here is that the software is used, Substance is used for the environment, for the car, but also for the helmet and the whole dress up of the pilot. You have seen right before how it's used at BMW with Max. I think there is nothing to add after this amazing live demo from Max. Also something we are working on together with Faurecia, a tier one supplier to the OEMs, car manufacturers. So expect to see more of it. We've been working together on this specific seat project, combining both scanning materials and procedural materials together for this specific project, and we will do a breakdown in the coming weeks. Other examples coming here from the UK, from ZeroLight. From ZeroLight, we are producing a VR experience based on a BMW M series, and that the kind of shots that they were able to release directly from the real-time experience. Affine Interactive, that's the kind of thing that can be produced also still in real time. And it's pretty amazing to check it out. There is some videos on YouTube. Don't hesitate to check it out. Last point is about what has been presented at Unite 2 days ago. So that's a screenshot of an experience that has been produced by a French company called Light and Shadows. They used Pixies for the conversion of the CAD data coming from Lexus, and they were able to produce a real-time experience in Unity, but when it's real-time, you need to see it real-time, no? So let's check it out. So that's running on my laptop. It's not a bad laptop, but it's definitely not a workstation. And you will see what kind of level of quality that can be reached today in Unity. So that's the real time. I can move around, of course, etc. There is some already made cameras you can go through. And most interesting with the real time is that you can interact with the model. So here, even if we are playing the video, we are able to change the color of the car. And we can even change the wheels in order to check out how it looks like. You can notice that even the tires is also changing when I'm changing the wheel. And so that's what is provided today by a game engine to visualization experts in the industry and to car designers to take decision about their model. Because the whole point of that is to take the right decision at the right time in order to achieve the highest level of quality of the final producted car. So I just wanted to show it to you. All right. We are about to finish. We will take questions afterwards. But there was one more thing. We received the email just right yesterday. So. But I wanted to share it with you, but I need to read the mail itself. So we wanted to share together with Autodesk important information. Autodesk is working on a project to support substance materials in Autodesk VRED. So that's pretty good news. All right, that was it. Thank you. Thank you very much. Question?
All right, time for questions.
What?
Yes.
When is Substance coming to VRED?
No comment.
Soon. Yes.
I actually, two questions. So when you do the wheel, you iterate on the wheel. So you code in the background somehow. So can you alter that code, I guess, the question?
Yeah. So you can, what you wanted is to add some scratches and things like that?
Yeah, scratches or your own design. For instance, if you have the side panel, you have a certain pattern on,
yep.
If you
yep.
want to input your own pattern, you need to alter the code, right? So how would you go about that?
So as you have noticed, the label that is, the sign that is just in the middle of the rim, we can tweak it, we can change the size, and we also open it as an for an input. And so if you are using a black and white image, then you can drive the geometry with your own input.
Gotcha, thank you.
Right, any other question? Don't worry, we won't eat.
No more questions?
Here we go.
Okay.
Hi, just wondering about the wheel system. Does it support vector displacement? Because now it's just, it goes up, right, out,
yeah.
Right? Does it also support vector displacement where you actually can go inside and?
So here, as Frederick may have noticed when we share the model, it's only this kind of displacement. It's not closed. That's why, for instance, Frederick explained, if you want to 3D print it, you have to close it to watertight it in order to finish the job.
Yeah, I think it's more, because displacement is just like goes from 0 to 1 upwards. Vector, you can actually do diagonals as well, and swirls, and things like that. Does it support that or not in there?
No, not yet.
No, okay, cool. Thank you.
Soon? Is that the answer?
Yes, soon, soonish.
Ask Alex.
Soon. Okay. All right, so if we don't have any more questions, thank you all for coming. It's not over. There's a cocktail happening right now on the first floor, so everyone's welcome. So yeah, hang out with us.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You so much.
And also, just one last thing. Just maybe before we go to the cocktail, maybe the people...